And I'm most proud of the almost 7,000 people that we registered to vote in the 30 days after the November general election. Like, people need to know that we do this. This is what we do, that the new Georgia is real, and that we are working to build a sort of an active, robust democracy where all people's voices are heard.
Hey, Grio fam, it's your girl, Natasha, and we are so honored today to have one of the heroes of this election in the building, Nsé Ufot, CEO of the New Georgia Project. Welcome to the Grio. How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you, Tasha?
I'm doing great. I'm sure you're a little bit more tired than I am because you've been on the front lines. First, just tell us the moment when you heard that Georgia flipped to blue in this election. What was that moment like? Where were you and just how did you react?
We were on the top of Stone Mountain, actually. I think so people need to know that because the margin of victory was so small, we went into an automatic recount. And so while we were feeling good about the first sort of calling of the numbers, we knew that they were going to contest the results. So some of my colleagues and I were on top of Stone Mountain. And for those who don't know, Stone Mountain is the largest Confederate monument on earth. And we were doing a photo shoot like as an act of resistance to highlight the work of the New Georgia Project. And it got called and we lost it. It was a really, really good feeling to know that the will of the people was finally being reflected in the results of our elections.
Yes, and we know that this victory did not come without some strategic hard work. Break it down for people who don't understand, what is so hard about voting in Georgia? What were some of the obstacles that were in people's way? And what did you do to address those obstacles?
Right, so, I mean, Georgia has a long and a recent history of voter suppression. Oftentimes when people hear voter suppression, you think, Bubba on the back of a pickup truck with a shotgun trying to intimidate Black voters. But let me be very clear, that still happens. The more pernicious, the more widespread voter suppression that we see are things like purges from the voter rolls, challenges to the voter rolls, the reduction in the number of polling locations. Georgia has closed about 10% of its polling locations. Even in the middle of a pandemic, Georgia has had no-fault vote by mail for the better part of a decade, but refusing to pay for postage. So, these young people who were born in 2002 and were voting for the first time in their elections, like part of our voter education had to be like, this is how much a stamp costs. This is where you can go get it. This is how you mail your ballot back. Our Secretary of State has launched another baseless nonsense investigation into us and our work, claiming that we're trying to register people who don't live in Georgia to vote, which is ridiculous. New Georgia Project, Georgia is in the name. And then add on top of all of that, the sort of disinformation that has colored our media and that Georgia voters were subject to sort of robocalls giving the wrong election date, targeting Black voters, billboards attempting to threaten voters, saying, voter fraud is a crime that carries with it a penalty of up to 10 years in prison and $100,000 in fines. Changes to the laws for formerly incarcerated citizens in terms of like what their rights are. People are terrified of reoffending. And so the idea that there isn't enough clarity about what their rights are when they, once they are off paper, once they've satisfied the terms of their sentence. So any of these things individually is a hurdle that Georgians have to clear in order to participate in our elections. But combined, they make up a system that is designed to make it more difficult for Black people and people of color to vote.
It's interesting because we know that obviously Stacey Abrams is a very high profile profile figure because she was running for governor, but she has given credit to so many Black women who've organized, such as yourself and others in the state. Why do you think Black women often end up in this position of being out front, leading, trying to make this change? But why do you think that's the case, specifically in Georgia?
There are a lot of reasons. I think that everyone comes to this work, you know, based off of their own life experiences. But what I do know is that, you know, being so close to the pain and to the oppression and sort of sitting at the intersection of anti-Blackness and white supremacy and the impacts that it has on us, on our communities, on our families, on our politics, but also sitting at the intersection of sexism and how it works and how it shows up in our movements. I think that the stakes are incredibly high. And so when you are looking at people who know how to get us out of this mess, who know how to sort of infuse joy and energy into our movements so that we can sustain ourselves so that for the long haul, for the fight, you know, the first place I look is for Black women and women of color, again, because you can't fix what you haven't faced, right? And the black women leaders that I'm like fortunate to be in community with, like the Queen, Stacey Abrams, like my sister, Latasha Brown, and others, again, having faced the ailments, the oppression that our communities are under, they know how to fix it. And so, yes, I regularly lean into their knowledge, their wisdom, and, you know, what we are building that will allow our communities to win, and like real wins, not just moral victories, but actual wins, and then defend those wins beyond one election cycle.
We've seen figures that say New Georgia Project has registered hundreds of thousands of voters, but can you just give us what is the most up-to-date number of how many voters you've registered?
Yeah, so we have registered 500,000 young people and people of color in all 159 of Georgia's counties.
That's half a million. Half a mil right there. That's not a small number.
No, not at all. And I'm most proud of the almost 7,000 people that we registered to vote in the 30 days after the November general election. Like, people need to know that we do this. This is what we do, that the New Georgia is real, and that we are working to build a sort of an active, robust democracy where all people's voices are heard. When we realized that we were going to be in a runoff position and that there were 23,000 Georgians that were turning 18 who needed to be registered to vote, we got to work. And it paid off. There were 123,000 Georgians who early voted in the runoffs, who didn't vote at all in the November presidential election. And so, flipping the state, showing people that their vote actually counts, right? That the margin between Vice President-elect Harris and President-elect Biden and the Trump ticket was 0.25%.
Wow. That's like, that's razor thin. And right. Say, when you talk to these first-time voters or some of these newly engaged voters, what do they say was keeping them from voting previously? And how did they react to knowing that they had this much power? Like, what type of reactions are you seeing from these newly engaged voters, particularly Black people?
I mean, it's been amazing to witness, I don't know if most people know that at the core of the work of the New Georgia Project is a very bold, very aggressive research agenda. So we're talking to Black people all day, every day, about what's at the top of their minds, what are their hopes, what are their fears for themselves, for their families, for their communities. And, people were very concerned about COVID and how clear it was that our leaders had abandoned us, that, you know, we had a president that was telling us to drink bleach, that a governor who lied about what he knew about COVID-19. And it's particularly egregious because, you know, Georgians know that the governor's mansion is 3 miles away from CDC's headquarters. And so, you know, when folks were talking about why they didn't vote in November, I mean, some of it was, again, the young people who hadn't reached 18 yet, folks who move, the purges. So folks didn't realize that they had been purged from the voter rolls until they showed up and tried to vote on election day and were turned away. And those people were determined to come back and vote in the runoffs. I mean, I would also say that, again, the folks who have experienced voter suppression themselves, I think about the 18,000 18-year-olds that we registered in 2018 who voted in the governor's race and who voted for Stacey Abrams. And they saw an election get stolen and no one held accountable. And so that is an attack on sort of our faith in the system. And so talking to folks about the power that we want to change our circumstances and how voting is an important part of that was a part of our persuasion messaging as well. So not just persuading people about who to vote for, but persuading people to vote and that their vote will count and that it's not a waste of time.
Listen, and it worked. That persuasion worked and it translated to a victory. So congratulations to you and the entire New Georgia Project and all of the organizers in the South. You know, I know a lot of folks from New York who packed up and moved to Georgia. So it's looking more and more like a good idea. Is the South ready for more of us to come down?
Come on. There's room. The water is warm. the eating is good.
There's literally more room.
There absolutely is more room. And I'll say that, you know, Georgia is going through a massive demographic shift. Political scientists and demographers are calling it the reversal of the Great Migration, right? The Great Migration between the 1920s and the 1970s, Black Americans fled racial violence in the South and went looking for economic opportunities, right? So Black folks in Chicago, a lot of them can trace their roots to Mississippi, right? Black folks in New York and New Jersey, many of them trace their roots to the Carolinas and to Georgia. And now we're in a moment where folks are moving back or their children are moving back. And I fully believe that that is one of the reasons why Georgia is in the place that it is, that it's in, because college educated Black folks, middle income and upper income Black people are moving back South, you know, buying homes, starting businesses, raising their families, and creating opportunities for a different kind of politics in the South.
All right, it's a different kind of politics. This is a different era. And yes, it's like coming home. We deserve to be able to come back home. Nsé Ufot of the New Georgia Project, thank you so much for being with us and congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.